So it is that hint of fall in the air, right? Seasons changing, things changing. And so what will God have for us coming up this fall and our kickoff? What will he have coming up for this in this new, really, the September is like the new year for a church. I think like right after Labor Day, the Sunday after Labor Day, we should wish everybody a happy new year, right? Because it's like the new year's in the church. So again, our bulletin here, everybody, has a few announcements. You'll find about the evangelism course. Tony, I know that that's continuing to go on, correct? Next couple of weeks, right? Then after Labor Day, my theology course will pick back up. And so also, I know some people have been interested in small groups. We're going to be talking with our leadership team, meets tomorrow evening. And during that discussion, we're going to talk about what's our fall kickoff going to look like. And so I want to just invite you all to think about what the Lord is doing in your life, to think about where you see God's hand working and what that might mean for the life here at Red Oak Church. And so with that being said, I'm going to tell you something that may make you want to run for the doors before our service starts. So you are being pre-warned, right, even before the first worship song. Today's spiritual discipline involves the discipline of repentance. Now, I'm sure that doesn't sound like it's going to be fun. And yet, what does Jesus say? The kingdom of God is at hand. Good news. Good news. The kingdom of God is at hand. And then he says, repent and believe the good news. So there's something tied to repentance that's good for the soul. There's something tied to repentance that carries with it the essence of the gospel. And so I invite each and every one of us to take a moment before we start and recognize that perhaps we have misunderstood the term repentance. Perhaps we thought, oh no, it's fire and brimstone. I don't want anything to do with this topic. And yet maybe, just maybe, the Lord might speak powerfully to our hearts today about this important and essential spiritual discipline. Because the heart that knows its own falls will bask in his grace. The heart that knows its own fallings will bask in his grace. Amen. With that being said, I'm going to invite Eric to come and give us the call to worship today, buddy.
Good morning, Red Oak.
Good morning, Eric.
Call of worship this morning is taken from Psalm 148. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the height.
Praise the Lord from the earth.
Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His majesty is above all and heaven. Praise the Lord.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hand hath made, I see the stars and I hear the rolling thunder.
Then sings my soul.
This is a great song about getting on our knees and having a repentant heart before the Lord. Every time I sing this, I'm struck by the line, even though you're gone and I'm cracked and dry, find me in the river. And of course, the Lord's never really gone. It's those times, you know, as it says in the footprints in the sand, that he carries us. But sometimes when we're really low, we can't feel him because we put all these resistances and blockers and things we use to defend ourselves emotionally in the way. And as we sing, I'm waiting here for you, I can't help but think that God might be saying at times, hey, I'm waiting for you to open up. And then there's those times when you really shut down and God says, I'm plowing through anyways and I'm reaching you. Pick you up and set your feet on high places. So be open to what God might do today, to the movement of His Spirit.
Find me in the river. Find me. To see the roses.
all who are weak. All who are weary, come to the rock. Come to the fountain. All who have sailed on the rivers of heartache, come to the sea. I want to share something while the band's playing. Something struck me when we were doing this song on Tuesday night. I'd never really seen it this way before, but as we were singing this song, I looked at these lyrics, and it said, all who have sailed on the rivers of heartache, come to the sea. Come on, be set free. And a river starts. Even if you look at the Connecticut River, it starts way up, I believe in New Hampshire-Vermont line. And it starts so small, you could actually just jump over it. And as it flows down, there's some twists and turns, there's the Holyoke Dam, there's all these different things, right? All these different things that could snag us along the way. And it's when it goes out into Old Saybrook, it's the largest, and it just pours out into the sea. And I think sometimes we forget that the rivers dump into the sea. And so if you look at that lyric right there, what's it saying? When you got a heartache, when you're sailing the rivers of heartache, you got to press on and you got to keep sailing because you know that it's going to dump into the ocean. It's going to dump into the place of your freedom and your liberation, where Christ will part the Red Sea if he has to, where he'll calm the storms. But the tendency in us is to get to the rough waters on those rivers of heartache and jump out and swim for the shore. But hear what Jesus says. Keep on sailing. When you hit the ocean, I've got something for you. But you gotta press through. Sometimes faith is tough, is it not? When suffering comes, is faith tough? Sometimes confusion comes, does it not? And you're going to be tempted, and the enemy's going to put in your head to bail on the ship. But Jesus is going to say, don't worry about the storms. I got those covered. Remember when I calmed them? Don't worry about what the water has for you. I'll teach you to walk on it. You just keep sailing through that river of heartache. Come to the sea. Come and be set free.
I love you, Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call to the Lord who is worthy of praise, and I have been saved from my enemies. The cords of death entangled me, the torrents of destruction overwhelmed me. The cords of the grave coiled around me, and the snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called to the Lord. I cried to my God for help. From his temple, he heard my voice. My cry came before him into his ears.
Good to be able to worship. It's like therapy for the soul. It's like this just incredible movement of God with his people. Every once in a while, it just hits you a certain way, and it just takes your breath away. It just captivates you, just moves you into your soul, and you know the Holy Spirit is working in your heart. Anybody feel that way? Where the Holy Spirit is working in your heart. Moments you just don't even want to stop worshiping, just let it pour out. You realize as you're pouring out to God and as you're praising Him, He's pouring into you. And it's a special moment where you realize that the reason you can keep pouring out is because the Holy Spirit keeps pouring in you. So God, I pray if anybody's sailing on the rivers of heartache today, that they sail that rudder right down to where it opens up in the horizon, where the sun, your son, the Son of God, shines bright in their life, and they realize the healing is not leaving the boat. The healing is not swimming for the banks. The healing is basking in the glory of your Son. So keep us sailing, Lord God. Keep us sailing. Where you lead us, Lord, we will follow. And oh, God, our God, sometimes where you lead are not the places that we want to go. Sometimes it's not the river that we feel like we want to be on. And yet there's an undeniable voice that says, keep sailing. Keep sailing. Oh, Lord, sometimes the enemy puts all kinds of things into our head. You're not going to make it around this bend, around this turn. Your boat's going to run aground here. You're going to bottom out. We got to tune that voice out. We got to learn to be still before you in moments where we want to react on impulse. Because we're a reactionary people, Lord God. Because it comes from our old hurts and our old hang-ups. Old habits that won't die. Old instincts, old ways we think we're defending our emotions. And in those midst, you just say, be still and know that I am God. Just be still before me. And know that I am God. Sail for the sunset. I want to actually sing that first verse again. Doesn't need to go, just on the acoustic guitar is fine. I don't know if you could put that up, Tiffany. I'm going to come down here and sing it together.
Don't who are we? And all who are weary,
sometimes I'm weary, Lord.
Come to the rock, come to the fountain.
Sing this with me now, come on.
And all who have sailed on the river.
All right, everyone, we're going to get down into some prayer, get our hearts right. If you hear me with a really gravelly, raspy throat, it's because I was singing at a concert in Weymouth yesterday. And so Weymouth was a little farther than I thought. It was like 2 hours. I was talking with somebody afterwards, and it was like getting to 9:30, and I'm like, whoa, I better get home. I got to preach in the morning, right? But thank you, Nikki. Nikki stepped up and is doing most all the songs today, so thank you, Nikki, for doing that. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for blessing us with your voice. Yeah. So, what's God doing in your heart? And I want to talk to you a little today about repentance, for sure. And I think we have a bad view of the concept of repentance. We think it means we're going to get beat down. And the tragedy of that understanding is it's from the knees of repentance that God raises us up. See, we think we're going to get down on our knees. No, I won't. Okay? And that as we're down on our knees, someone's going to come with the Bible and bang us off the top of the head, and before you know it, we're flat out on the ground. That's not how it works. That's not how it works. It's when you hit your knees and you realize, and sometimes you have to get to that, oh, wretched man that I am place, you know? That the Lord calls you to get up. To get up and keep sailing. But I'm going to tell you, there's I've preached on repentance before, and this spirit, we're going through all the spiritual disciplines, and I will not cut this one out because it's healthy for the soul. I'll talk more about that in a minute. But there's going to be an interesting slant or angle this time about the concept of repentance. It's not just repenting for, you know, this or that or the other thing. There's going to have a specific meaning, and I've never preached on this passage before, certainly not in the context of repentance, but I don't think ever. And so it's going to be a different angle, and I want you to just see what the Lord might say to you today. All right, so we're going to go into prayer, and I want you to just open your heart. I want you to get the soil of your heart open to the Holy Spirit's movement. Where will you take us today, Lord? Where will you lead us that we should follow? What river do we need to keep sailing on, even if it stings at times? Come to the sea and be set free. If you lead us, Lord, we're going to follow. So let's take a moment and say, Lord, where are you leading me? And then, Pastor Don, I'll ask you to close after you give us a little time of silence to get our heart right, and then pray for the message today. Thank you.
Loving God, thank you for this time, this beautiful, quiet time where we can turn to you and absorb the grace that you have, that despite our sin, you love us so much. Lord, we come to get together today, not as a coincidence. We come together today to absorb a divine moment where we can feel you moving in our hearts. Lord, your word is precious to us. Your word is a love letter to us. So we pray as we continue our service, that we will give you honor and glory, and that we will especially be appreciative of your precious word, which instructs us and guides us. We're thankful also, Lord, that you have given this task to Pastor Ryan today. So grant unto him the anointing of your Spirit as he preaches. May we not only hear him, but more importantly, hear that still small voice, hear you in our hearts. So, Lord, bless the words that he says and bless our hearing. And bless us with the living word, Lord Jesus. For we ask it in his precious name. And all God's children said, amen.
I will follow. I'll tell you a little vacation story from when this past vacation was about a month ago, Nikki. I think we went to Martha's Vineyard. It's about a month ago. And went to this beach that I grew up on, going year after year after year. It's called South Beach in Martha's Vineyard. Anybody been there? I know you've been there. All right. And as a kid, I had such fond memories of going to South Beach. The waves, we used to body surf the waves. They had great waves there. We used to play football on the beach. I'd be out there in a tube. A wave would knock me over. The tube would go like 400 yards out to sea, and I'd watch my father swim after it for me. It was good times. It was good times. He'd come back like, thanks, Dad. I remember setting up volleyball on the beach, right? When I came back and worked out there for college, we had volleyball games on the beach. It was like some of the best childhood memories that I remember. We're going to Martha's Vineyard to South Beach, okay? And so this past vacation, I was all fired up. I'm like, we're going to South Beach. And we came right where to the where you park, and you walk down, and you walk over the dune onto the beach, and I expected to see this brawling beach and ocean, and I turned the corner to the left, and I said, where'd the beach go? The erosion had taken almost the entire beach. You weren't going to play football on that beach. You weren't going to play volleyball. I'm not sure you could walk your dog on that beach. We sat there, remember this, and a wave came up. We were all the way up against the grass dunes, where the beach, you can't go back any further, and if you do, you're gonna be loaded with ticks. And we were all the way in the back, and a big wave came up and soaked our entire towels. And I thought, the beach eroded. This was like, oh, such a precious childhood memory. I'm like, what's gonna happen? What are they gonna do? How are we gonna get the beach back, you know? And I remember just kinda sitting there going, man, what happens when things erode away? And there's a process common in rivers. And so if you think about the song we sang, the rivers of heartache which dump into the sea, right? There's this process called silting. Anyone ever heard of silting? What it is? I don't know too much about it. I just know what I was able to research about it. It's the erosion of the soil caused by toxins, silt, that contaminates the river. And so what happens is this silting process, this erosion process, gets down under the layers of the soil, brings up this silt, and then just floods. You've seen pictures in the river with so much silt, you can't even recognize the color of the river. It looks completely discolored. Well, there's a lot of spiritual truth to this, and Jesus is going to speak through the prophet John in the book of Revelation and talk about the church at Ephesus. How many of you have heard the book of Ephesians, right? That's written by Paul to the church at Ephesus. And Jesus is going to talk about the churches in this passage in Revelation. And there's something very unique to Ephesus. The river, the Caistor River in Ephesus, had such bad silting that they had to relocate the heart of the city. The silting was so bad in the river that went through it that they actually had to relocate, if you can imagine that. And so when you get to this passage in Revelation, I want you to understand the background. I want you to think about that kind of first love I had as a kid in vacation, watching the whole beach erode. I want you to think about a city that's going to be spoken to here, where the silting and the erosion had been so bad they had to relocate. They couldn't have the same kind of habitat there anymore. And it's in that physical context that Jesus is going to speak a very important spiritual reality that has a lot to do with repentance and even more to do with the way we love God and the way we love each other. Revelation chapter 2, verse 3. I know you are enduring patiently and bearing up for my name's sake, and you have not grown weary. That sounds encouraging, right? Ephesus, you're doing well. You're doing better than some of the other churches that Jesus mentions in these passages. But, oh, here it comes. But I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Your first love has begun to erode. Now, if you could just put your mind in Ephesus, if you were in Ephesus at the time, you would have thought about this probably a little differently, right? Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen. Repent and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. I'm going to take away my light for you as a church. And he's not necessarily talking about each and every individual, but he's talking about as a collective whole, as a body of Christ. I'm going to take my lampstand and relocate it. Now, that's got to strike a chord to the people there who have relocated because things have eroded. And what's Jesus saying? I'm going to relocate you if you continue to erode the love that you had at first. And notice he says, not only that you have abandoned the love that you have at first, right? But you failed to do the works that you did at first. And so he calls them to repentance. Now, whenever you hear the word repentance, people get, Well, I got a little challenge for you. If your loved one or yourself had cancer, and you found out that there was a surgeon who could absolutely do an operation and absolutely 100% cure that. He had to go in. Things had to get opened up a bit. But he was going to take what was ailing you and absolutely could fix it. Would you not run or take your loved one and run to that place? Well, then why don't we think about the same thing spiritually? Why are we afraid to talk about what ails us in here and what's broken in here and where we've fallen and get tripped up over and over again here? See, repentance is only a bad thing if you don't believe Jesus can heal you. If you doubt Jesus can heal your heart and heal the brokenness in you, if you doubt that, you will want nothing to do with the operation of repentance. Zero. Don't put that scalpel near me. But if you believe that when Jesus says, good news, the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe this good news. If you really are absolutely confident that Jesus is the healer of your soul, you'll say, open me up, Jesus. Do whatever you got to do. Let's take this out. Amen? It all depends on where your hope is. How strongly you really believe where you heal me, Lord, I will go. If you truly believe that, you'll be skipping out of here. I can't go out to Memos or any place else today. I got to get home and get on my knees. Because if it was physical, you'd run for it. You'd run right to it. So let's rework this idea of repentance. The operation for what ails the soul. I'm going to tell you there's some controversy, back and forth among scholars. So put on an academic hat for just 1 minute. We're not going to go into a Bible study. But some people say that when Jesus says you've abandoned the love you had at first, right, that he's talking about himself, that they don't love him anymore. Other people say, well, no, it says that they're failing to do the works that they did at first. They're not taking care of each other, their first love as a church. And then there's those like myself who absolutely believe it's both. That the church at Ephesus had abandoned their love for Christ because and in lieu of also abandoning their love for each other as the church. And that's where I stand in this passage. Right? Look at Matthew 25. Pastor Don, you're going to get ready to do this thing for me like Tuesday, all right? Get those arms lubricated. Here we go, right? Matthew 25, verse 37. Then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you a drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? And the king will answer them, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these my brothers, you did it to me. Pause there before you go on any further. This is an often, in my opinion, misquoted verse. Okay? People use this verse to talk about taking care of everybody in the world. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't help anybody. We should help anybody. Anyone who's sick. And I agree with that statement. But this verse says, as you did it to one of the least of these brothers of mine. This is a verse talking about the way we take care of each other in the church. It's saying that the love that we have as we do it, if I believe, Eric, that you have Jesus Christ in your heart, if I believe that when Paul says, I've been crucified with Christ, it's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me, if I believe Jesus Christ is in there, then as I do it to you, I do it to him. You see how that works? He's talking about the children of God. These brothers of mine, these sisters of mine, you did it to me. And then he goes on, right, in verse 41. Then he will say to those on the left, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal flame prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, you gave me no food. I was thirsty, you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, you didn't welcome me. Naked, you didn't clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. And they also will answer, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, or stranger or naked or sick or in prison, and did not minister to you? And they will answer, and then he will answer them, saying, truly I say to you, as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. I guess in some ways, this is about repenting for the sins of omission. The things that we should do that we don't. Now, I've preached plenty of times on repentance for the things you did, but Jesus has some strong words for the church at Ephesus because they forgot him and they forgot each other. They forgot the love in their heart. And a lot of times we throw around the word love very cheap these days. If there's two words, I think, that have been cheapened, one is discipleship, the idea of following Jesus even when there's a cost, and the second word is love. And maybe not in that order either. Love becomes this careless, frivolous word that's based purely on emotion. But Jesus says it's got to move to action. It's got to move in the way we love and take care of each other. You abandon your first love and you fail to do the things that you did at first. And this is so true in our spiritual walk. We come in at first, we're on fire from the Lord. We want to help. We want to do what we can. Our whole lives are being turned around. We can't do enough. And then all of a sudden, as we plateau after a while, it's you just come in and you sit in your pew and you leave. And Jesus is saying to that, listen, we got to get on our knees and we got to remember that he's our first love. And if he's our first love, than these people right here. I gotta love them with all my heart too. Pastor Don, do your vertical and horizontal illustration. Are you ready for a Pastor Donism? Yes, okay.
I don't know about an ism, or I have no idea here. But one of the things I want you to realize, and one of the first things you learn in seminary, is God loved you first, amen? That's grace. And you know what? How do you thank God? Well, you love him back, yes. But God wants his poured love into our hearts so that we could not only love him, but hear me out, but to love each other. Because if you don't love each other, you aren't loving God. It's that simple. Because one is related to another. So when anybody asks you what you believe, you go like this.
That's a Pastor Donism. Yeah. The love for Christ and his church fuels the spiritual rivers of the Holy Spirit. An erosion of love for Christ and his church causes the pollutants, causes the silt to get in the way of the life-giving waters of the Spirit. And Christ is threatening to relocate this church that has failed to love him and also love each other. Listen to Jesus, what he's saying. Get back to your first love. I know that the rivers have some ups and downs. I know that the rivers are sometimes you're wide open and sometimes the rivers are heartache. But we got to press on for him, and we got to press on and carry each other. You see someone swimming for the shore, you got to be willing to say, get in the boat with me. Because Jesus is carrying us all the way to the promised land. We can't abandon our first love. This sermon is about repentance for being dismissive of what it means to be the church. And every one of us, look, you read, if you, rabbit trail, if you're walking here and you say, I don't need any repentance for anything, I'm all set, I'd take care of the church just fine, okay? Listen, you open up the books of Acts. We had an interesting small group after Tuesday's service. And we were blown away at what they were doing to take care of each other. All they wanted to do was be together. They met together all the time to carry each other, to give to each other as they needed. They had each other's backs like you can't imagine. And you know why? Because they were being persecuted. And persecution has a funny way of bonding people together. Persecution in tough times has a funny way of saying, we can't stay divided. We better join hands. I got your back, you got mine. As you've done it to the least of these brothers of mine, you've done it to me. What does that mean to you today? How is Jesus calling you to your first love? Calling you to not only love him, but to love his people, his church. The church is called the bride of Christ. The bride of Christ. Look, I'm going to give an analogy. If you can't stand my wife, you can't stand me. Because there's a union there. And it ought not to be divided. And I've been a part of that years ago, before I got into ministry, before I went into seminary, when I decided I had to find Jesus on my own terms. I said, well, Jesus, I think I'm coming around to you, but I don't know about the church, because I saw a lot of things growing up. And the Lord absolutely, in so many ways, I'm just saying the word rebuked me, but it took a while for that to really light bulb to go off. And realize it doesn't work that way, Ryan. You got to invest in people. I got to love people even when they stab you in the back. We got to love each other even if we're let down, because it's a community of faith. And Jesus Christ doesn't give up on his church, so why would we? If Jesus doesn't give up on the church, why would we? Listen, think about it this way. If you pollute the river, you're getting relocated to the desert. If you pollute the river, if you got no love, don't be surprised if you feel a little dry. Don't be surprised if it feels like the desert. The point for today is sometimes we're dry because we stopped loving Christ and the church. And I'm going to give you a few reasons why I think that happens. Give you a few reasons. One, it's currently trendy to be anti-church. I'm going to say it. I'm going blunt here. It's trendy. It's trendy to say, well, I'll be all right with God. I'll worship him alone on a mountain. When's the last time you did it? It's trendy to say, I'm very spiritual, right? And you know, I'm going to take a real rabbit trail here. Hope it doesn't go too long, right? And I'm not going to say that I never said this at a point in time in my life, but it's become trendy to say I'm spiritual and not religious. Listen, Jesus in many ways comes against spirit of religion at times, when it's controlling and when it's legalistic and all that kind of things. I'm not denying that. However, where it moves from just spiritual to religion is when I say our walk, my walk is united to his walk and your walk. And as soon as you come together, you don't just have your own walk. You see, Jesus takes our paths and he intertwines them and he mixes them and we grab hands with each other. And my first love has to be tied to these people right here. And if you want to call that religion or whatever you want to call it, I just don't like how trendy it's become to say, I'm just going to do my own, as if a spiritual walk is its own path. It was never that way, brothers and sisters. And when persecution comes, it won't be that way going forward. I can guarantee you that. You might find people say, I think I need the church. I think I need each other. I think we need each other. Look at Ephesians 5, 25 through 27. Husbands, love your wives. Say this with me. As Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkles or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. Do you think Jesus loves the church? I've been preaching for a few weeks about how much Jesus loves you. Let me read on all the spiritual disciplines of meditating on the word, right? Of prayer, not corporate prayer, but individual prayer. All the things that we've been talking about, building that inner man. This is a very transitional sermon in the spiritual discipline series. It's going from the concept of just me and my spiritual disciplines to us. So I want you to hear today, not only does Jesus love you, but Jesus loves us. The very concept of us, the very fabric of us, our Father who art in heaven. And we have a culture that likes to say only my Father who art in heaven. I think we all, myself included, can get down on our knees in some way. Number two, selfishness. Number one is trendy. Number two, pure selfishness. Some people will use the church simply for themselves, for their own empowerment, for their own prestige, for their own sense of glory. Romans 12:1 gives us a different view of what church life should be. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living what? Sacrifice. Holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Church is not a place to get your own way all the time. It's not a place to have yourself propped up. It's not a place just for you to feel empowered. It's a place, one of the biggest thrills I got to have as a pastor is watching all of us grow and mature in the body of Christ. Everybody find their spiritual gift. Everybody see the priesthood of all believers. Everybody find their calling in God. That's what it means to be a church. It's not a one-man show. It's not one person who runs the whole thing. It's loving each other so much that I can't wait to see us all discover the calling we have in Jesus Christ. And selfishness can kill what the Lord wants to do in a church. Thank God for his sovereignty. Thank God that he can plow through us when we make mistakes and carry his vision forward, right? Amen? So number one was it's trendy. Number two is it's pure selfishness. Number three, sometimes we're cracked and dried, waiting in the river, wondering why we feel like we're in the desert, because our view of Christianity is merely a box that we checked on the end of those online contracts that says, do you affirm the statements above to be true to the best of your ability and knowledge? If your Christianity is that checkbox that says, okay, I believe this to the best of my knowledge, now I'm just going to wait and see what happens when I die. Don't be surprised if you find yourself going, even though I'm gone and I'm cracked and dry, find me in the river. I'm waiting here for you. This life, I want you to hear this again because I've said it twice now. Good news. The kingdom of God is at hand. This is not a contract you check that you attest to affirm this belief, and then you wait around. We are not in a holding pattern. We are not in a waiting pattern. We are living out a piece of the kingdom of God until it comes in full. If it's true, remember this and this, right? Pastor Don, I hope you remember because it just happened like 7 minutes ago, okay? This and this, right? If it's true that when Jesus comes, he says, the kingdom of God is at hand. Well, if Jesus Christ is here in us, then the kingdom of God is still at hand. And there's still work to be done. And what does Jesus say? I have this against you, Ephesus. You abandoned your first love. You forgot the things that you used to do. You forgot the way you used to take care of each other. You forgot to keep the kingdom alive until I bring it in full. Christianity cannot, should not, and must not be a holding pattern between here and heaven. It's got to be a river that sails us to the ocean, but we still have some sailing to do along the way. We still have people to call from the sides of the shore along the way. We still have hearts for each other. We have to live out the kingdom of God until we experience it in full. Amen? And that's what the church is. That's who the church is. The church is the tangible piece of kingdom that has Jesus Christ alive in us through the Holy Spirit. And if that's not your version of church, this ain't the right church. It's not a holding pattern. It's not just a bunch of traditions. What's Jesus say? For the sake of your traditions, you can make void the word of God. And I'm not talking about whether we keep the doxology. I'm talking about just going through the motions. Ah, it's a little bit of a hard word. And just when you think, oh, what's that mean for me? Hear it again. No, no, no. This type of repentance is good news. Good news. The kingdom is here. Number four, the love is there, but it isn't your first and primary love anymore. Look at Matthew 13:44. Kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field which a man found and covered up. Then in his what? His what? In his joy, he goes and sells all he has and buys that field. In his joy, he sacrificed all the material things that we think are going to make us happy because he found a greater joy. What is your greatest joy? Is your greatest joy in the material things? Is your greatest joy in the things that rust and moths can destroy? Is your greatest joy tied to merely worldly things? Because you will find yourself cracked and dry. And what Jesus is saying is the treasure is right here. I'm going to embarrass you, Kathy. I have watched you grow in the Lord. From the time you came in here, first time saying, I'm gonna give this faith thing a chance. And I just watch you. I watch you come to theology class. I've watched you just grow and grow. You're bringing things to the fellowship hall. I'm just watching you. You're talking about how you can help and how there's gonna be, you know, what you can do in the church. You're having meetings about it. I'm just watching the Lord blossom and bloom. You know why? Because the treasure is right here in all of us, and you're part of it. The treasure's right here, Don. The treasure's right here. You are part of this treasure. Understand what's being said. The kingdom community, the kingdom life is the treasure. And do we really value each other and Jesus Christ more than all the things that accumulate us over and over again? Soon as you get rid of stuff and simplify, all of a sudden things get layered back on and on again, and Jesus saying, where's your true treasure? And what Jesus is really saying is the treasure's right here. Kelly, you're part of the treasure. Do we really believe that? Because that's how the early church, they were literally just giving up the stuff for each other so that they could take care of each other. They had such a dynamic faith because they were being persecuted and they needed to rally together. And in their joy, they were coming together and forsaking other things because they believed in what the Lord was doing in their lives together. In their joy, they got rid of it all because the treasure is right here. This whole world's gone mad looking for happiness. Gone mad looking for happiness. What if it was right here in front of us all along? And it isn't the pews. I'm here. Yes. Happiness just said, yeah. By the way, that's the greatest name. I need to talk to your parents who named you Happiness. I love that name, right? Happiness. She says, I'm right here. You're the happiness. You're the treasure. It's right here. People spend their whole lives looking for it. Look what we got here. Is it a treasure to you? I mean, is it really a treasure to you? Your first love has to be nurtured and developed. It's got to be invested in or it grows stale. And the devil will try to trick you into the art of withdrawal. Withdrawal. The times that you're the down, the times we need each other the most are more often than not the times that people retreat. I want you to think about that. That's a deep thought. The times that people need someone the most, need their church family the most, are oftentimes people withdraw the most. It is true, yeah. And that's the devil's game. Where is the priority? Where's your first love? Now, I had an illustration to close us with, and as it would be, God, you know, I love when God does something and you can just sit back and say, smile and say, okay, I got you. I have this illustration I want to share with you, and then I'm going to ask somebody to come up briefly. Has anyone ever heard the illustration about the jar with the golf balls, the rocks, and the sand? Okay. If you haven't, I'm going to say it to you, and if you have, I want you to reconsider it again. Teacher comes into class. He brings a jar, big jar. Right? He takes out a bunch of golf balls. And he fills the jar up to the top with golf balls. He looks at his class. He says, is the jar full? They go, yeah, you can fit another one in there. And then he grabs a whole pail of rocks, little tiny rocks. And he pours it in, and they go through all the creases of the golf balls, all the spaces, and fills it up to the top. And he looks at the class, he says, now is the jar full? They go, oh yeah, it's full now. Right up to the top. And then he takes a bucket of sand. Probably got it from South Beach, that's why there's no sand there anymore. testing. And he takes the bucket of sand, and he pours it in, and it soaks in all the spots where the pebbles are. Right up to the top, and now it's hard packed. And he looks at the class, says, now is it full? Go, oh yeah, professor, now it's full. Now it's full. And then he takes his cup of coffee off the desk and he pours it in. And the liquid just soaks up into the sand. And everybody agrees that now it's full. And he said, the moral of this is, if I put the sand in first, even as small as a grain of sand is, I don't have any room for the golf balls, for the things that are the most important in my life. If I put the rocks in first, all the little details, all the things that we think are so important, all the things that the man sold just to get the field that had the real treasure. And if you fill your life with that, there'll be no room for the big stuff, the most important stuff, your first love, God and each other. There'll be no room for it. So make sure that when you fill your life, you're filling it with the things that really count, the things that matter the most to you. Fill it with your first love, if you will. And then they said, okay, professor, well, what's the coffee all about? He says, well, no matter how full your life is, you always have time for a cup of coffee with a friend. Now, I had this little silly analogy prepared to talk about the priority of our life together in this kingdom community known as the church. And as I was walking in this morning, Bob Gursky, Bob, come on up here real quick, will you? Bob, he comes up to me and he says, hey, I got something to show you. You know how people mark golf balls? Now, you're a big golfer, right? He says, you know how people mark their golf balls so that they know, you know, which one's theirs? If you're like me, mine's the one in the woods, okay? And he says, can I see this for a minute? He says, I got this idea from somebody and I mark it with the cross. Now, I don't think it was a coincidence that you brought me this today when I was planning this illustration. And the reality is, there's a lot of people who'd rather play golf than serve Jesus Christ and his church. And if it's not golf, I'm not knocking you golfers. Okay? There's plenty of other things. I got my own things. When you look at that, do you see, what priority do you see? Do you see the worldly things? Or does Jesus draw you to the foot of the cross and say, as I loved you, love each other? What are the real golf balls in your life? Thank you, Bob. Bob, you couldn't have set me up any better. Keep listening to the Lord. Did you just drop the golf ball? I don't know how to tie that in. Bob, I'm not going to lie to you. I don't know how to tie that in. Sometimes your priorities fall down and roll under the radiator. But listen, again, if you pollute the river, you may find yourself in the desert. But I gotta close us with some good news. Because here is the God we serve, the God who calls us together. And he says, instead of your shame, when you hit your knees, when you fall down and say, God, I need to love like you love. Here's what he says. Instead of your shame, there shall be a double portion. Instead of your dishonor, they shall rejoice in their lot. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess a double portion. They shall have everlasting joy. A double portion was not given to one person. It just wasn't given to the king. It was given to the people. And what if the double portion that we get, brothers and sisters, maybe it's not the new material items that we think we need. What if the double portion was seeing that all this treasure that's filling these pews doubles? What if the treasure is that when we get to pour our hearts to each other and bond in our small groups and find connections and have each other's back? What if the double portion has nothing to do with the material? What if it has to do with finding the treasure in the field and selling everything? Metaphorically, you don't have to go sell your house, okay, right? And finding out that the treasure exists right here and that God has a double portion of it for us. When we love like him, where does the church fit in your jar? And what is the Lord calling you to today?
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this message, and we thank you for your precious word. And sometimes, Lord, soul searching, matter of fact, all times, soul searching is good. As we evaluate ourselves, our priorities. But may we never forget that the church is the bride, your bride. And the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. Give us a bold belief, Lord, that we belong to you, but we also belong to each other. Help us, O Lord, to take this message, put it in our hearts, and walk from here a changed person. Lord, if there's someone here today who doesn't know you, let them remain and let them be led to the Lord. If there's someone here today that needs to revive their love for the church, let that happen today. Now is the acceptable time of the Lord. Now is the acceptable time to repent and change and turn. Now is the acceptable time to be filled with thee. Amen and amen.
Good news, everybody. Amen. We get a chance to go on our knees. Good news, not bad, good. Listen, in all seriousness, if you have it in your heart to rededicate your life to your first love, I'll invite you to come forward. Tony, I know you'll pray for people. Jim, I know you'll pray for people. Irene, Lynn, Lamoth, I know that there's people who would love to pray. Okay? And if you just want to sit by yourself, just look. Nobody will be offended and say, I just need a moment with myself. But I invite people to come forward if they want and rededicate their life to the Lord and to his bride. breathe. Just keep singing that for the Lord. One more to the glory of the Lord. Sing it to Him. Your blessing right now to give us renewed vision of what it means to be your church, what it means to love each other unconditionally. If we don't learn it here, how will we ever learn it with the world? We got to learn it here first. We have heard your word. We have heard your call. Leap from the pages. We will not abandon our first love. The fire of God will raise us up. Amen. Go in peace, everyone.